program. He also worked at BIIT Jhansi as a lecturer, senior lecturer and reader. His research interest mainly involves digital signal processing. He has published more than 50 papers in the journals of repute and international conferences. He has delivered lectures as an expert speaker in more than 50 programs like FDP, STP and STT. He is a fellow of IETE, life member of IE and member of IEEE. Hence, I welcome you, sir, for this lecture session. And I also hand over to you. Sir, kindly, you can please proceed with your presentation. Sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Nayanta madam. Thank you. Thanks for inviting you for this session. And thanks for your kind introduction. So on behalf of the department as well as the university, once again, I, Dr. Krishna Raj, welcome you all. Basically, I am also thankful to you all that you people are supporting us by participating in the FDP. Today we are going to discuss about the design and implementation of the system. As we have gone through so many lectures, and in these lectures we have covered about the devices and how the advanced semiconductor materials will be utilized in order to develop the new devices here. So, in this one, we are just going to describe the concept how these developed advanced semiconductor devices will be utilized during the time of the implementation of our algorithm. So for that purpose, we will just go for a case study which we used to cover during our very basic study program, that is in BTech here, and see here when we are interested in order to design any system. First of all, we have to define, that is, what is the definition, what we are trying to design. When we say we are interested in order to design a system, then we have to define the system. What is the system? Then we define it in a very different manners, having the different purposes and the different useful meanings here. For example, we define it as a collection of the parts that works together to achieve a goal or task, or we also define it as a set of the subjects and the relationship among the objects viewed as a whole and designed to achieve a purpose. And sometimes we say this is an open loop system, and sometimes we say this is a closed loop system, depending upon the situation and the requirement. So the here the first step is to define the system, and then we try to introduce the effectiveness in our system. When we say effectiveness in our system, effectiveness is nothing but we try to involve the effective methodology and in our system. And effectiveness is nothing but this is a function of the human skills, software and hardware. Means these four components, these three components, that is the human skills, software, hardware and some other parameters, are arranged in a specific manner in order to get our desired goal or the desired output of the system. So after here the definition, that is, what is the here the our system and how we will develop an efficient algorithm or the system, these are all related to the definition of the system. Then we move towards the practical approaches. As we know, if what we define or what we desire, that is basically here the ideal. Because here the whatever is the requirement, that is the ideal. But we are trying to design it, and we are also trying to implement it so that we can deploy it for the purpose of the for the useful purposes of the society here. So here for this purpose, we have to here the specify our problem here, or we have to specify the system. And for that purpose, we have to introduce some algorithm rules and regulations that converts the requirement into the practical approaches form. And when we apply these rules, regulations, then it becomes the specification, that is also known as the determination of the parameters. And then we decide whether we are interested in order to design the static system or the dynamic system. We are just trying to cover here the case study, which we have gone through during our basic courses here. So here after this one, whether we are interested for the static system or the dynamic system. And we know static system means without any memory, and the dynamic system means that has some memory here. So if we define any static system, it is only the polynomial or the set of the polynomials. And when we say the dynamic system, naturally we have to introduce here some energy storing devices or the elements. For and after the decision of the system, that is whether we are going for the dynamic system and the static system, necessarily we will move towards the dynamic system here. And after this decision, we have to decide which one is better, analog or the digital system. We have gone through these concepts that the digital are better in some aspects of the processing here. And the analog systems are here the represented with the help of the differential equations, and the digital systems are represented with the help of the difference equations. And when we say the difference equation, this is represented something like in this manner. See, here it is a mathematical modeling. When we try to define the function, that is the functionality of the system, then we use the mathematical model here. And we are trying to model here, or we are trying to discuss the model of the digital system. And since the digital system are represented with the help of the difference equations, so this equation, this is the general equation here. That is the yn is summation of, here the, we have considered the negative sign. Because if we see, then these terms will be towards the left side and these terms towards the right side here. And we have transferred here the all terms towards the right side related to the yn, except only the k is equal to 0 here. And for that purpose, we have considered here the b0 as 1. So this may be considered as a general representation of the digital system in one dimensional digital system here. And this is the minus bk yn minus k summation from k is equal to 0 to n with the negative sign, plus the second term is ak xn minus k is equal to 0 to m. And now we see, then similarly we can represent here the two dimensional equations for the digital system also, and here using the differential equations we can represent here the two dimensional analog system here. These are the examples of the representation of any system. Now depending upon the here the and this term, that is the here the derivation of the mathematical model is known as the mathematical modeling or the derivation of the system. And the second here we have covered the three section. One is the definition, second is the decision, and the third one is the derivation here. Now the on the depending on the value and nature of the coefficient, here we see we will have the two types of the coefficient, AKs and BKs. BKs are responsible for the feedback, and AKs are responsible only for the feed forward method here, or feed forward positions only. So if we see here the coefficients AKs and BKs, then AKs and BKs may be considered constant with respect to time, or they may change their values with respect to time. Now if we again see here the mathematical model, then we can say that these equations are nothing but they represent the parameters of our system or our algorithm for which we are interested to design it. And here depending upon the values of the AKs and BKs, whether the AKs are invariant with the time or they are changing their values with respect to time, they are again categorized into two categories. If they are constant and they are not changing their values with respect to time, then that one is known as the deterministic or the approach or the linear time invariant system. And if they are changing, it means if the parameters are changing, means here the components of the system are changing their values as per the need or as per the situation, it means that type of the system will become the adaptive or the stochastic system here. Now here whatever is the type of the system, whether it is the LTI system or it is the adaptive system, then again we move towards the one other approach, that is named as the what is the response of the system. And depending upon the response of the system, we categorize it into different categories like the low pass filter, high pass filter, band pass, band stop. These are the different types of the categorization under which we categorize the our design system or the algorithm. And now if we see, then we will find whatever is the type, whether it is the LTI system or it is the adaptive system, both may be categorized into two categories. One is without feedback and second one is with feedback. If there is no feedback, and that will be represented only with the here the second term. And if we see, then this is nothing but this one is the moving average model here. And if there is a first term also, that is there is feedback, then there is autoregression, and this is known as the autoregressive type of the system here. So whatever we have developed here, the model, or whatever we have defined this model, this is known as the ARMA model. And moving average is also known as the finite impulse response system, because this type of the system, when it is the system when it will be subjected to impulse as the input for the purpose of the disturbances or the here the input here, then what will happen? we will get here the finite response after some duration. But in the case of the feedback, we will get here the there is an infinite time duration that requires the to get here the settled result or the finite here the steady response. It means this is the second one is the infinite impulse response system. Now this after this categorization, we can also see here the purpose of the analysis. We utilize here the different types of the transformation. For example, in the differential domain, we use the Laplace transformation, and in the digital or the differential equation, we use the J transformation. And when the in the Laplace transformation, when S is replaced by the J omega, and in the J transformation, when J is replaced by e to the power j omega, when we consider only the oscillatory position or the oscillation section, then it is known as the Fourier transform. And when if this Fourier transform is applicable for the discrete time system, then it is known as the DTFT. And DTFT after sampling, it becomes the DFT. And when we exploit the properties of the periodicity and the this one that is symmetricity, then the processing of the DFT becomes very, very fast, and that is known as the FFT. But in all these cases, there is limitation because these are suitable only for the non-stationary signal. So for the purpose of the stationary signal, we used to use here the different types of approaches. That is, the first one was of course the STFT, then we moved towards the wavelet transformation, either the continuous wavelet transformation or the discrete wavelet transformation. So these are the different types of the tools or the approaches that are used in order to analyze our design system here. And now we are moving towards the approximation. Say if we have analyzed here the frequency response of the design system for which we have developed the mathematical model, then we move towards a type of the criteria, design criteria, that is known as the approximation. Either we can utilize this approximation that is available, or we can develop our own approximation for the purpose of the designing here. And during the time of the designing, we have to introduce here the approximation. For example, if we consider in the digital signal processing system, we used to use the different types of the approaches or the approximation for the here the moving average or the FIR filter. We used to use the equiratory least squares Windows method for the purpose of the designing. Similarly, in the IIR case, we first design the analog system, then it is transformed to the digital system. And for that purpose, we can utilize here the Butterworth series ability. There are so many approaches here, but these are the approximation. That is the design criteria that will be utilized here. Now, after this design criteria, we have to develop the algorithm that is VLSI implementable algorithm here. And we have to introduce some efficiency here. That is, we are interested in order to enhance the performance of the design algorithm. And for that purpose, we have to utilize the different types of the languages or the different types of the graphical representation. And when we have designed any algorithm or the system, or we can say when we have developed any algorithm, then that algorithm is said to be the infinite precision algorithm, because we have assumed that all the parameters or the information have been transformed from one domain to another domain, but it is not true. When we try to simulate it, or when we try to implement it, either in the hardware or in the software, it depends upon the platform or the target. Means, for example, if we are using any particular processor, then whatever is the length of word length of that processor, that will matter during the time of the implementation of our algorithm. So there is again one need that is known as the quantization, or we can say that is the need conversion of the infinite precision into the finite precision here. Now, as we have discussed in the very beginning, that for the purpose of the functional description, we have to use the mathematical model. And in the functional description or the functional designing, we are not worried about the internal processing part or architecture or the algorithm or the system. And in order to utilize and exploit the properties of the architecture of the algorithm as well as the system, we have to describe it using either the different types of the languages or different types of the graphical representation. For example, in language, we use the descriptive language, prescriptive language, and applicative languages here. in applicative languages, there is no meaning of the assignment, means which assignment comes at which level. It is not a matter in the case of the applicative languages, but it matters in the case of the prescriptive languages. Applicative languages, the example of the applicative languages are the MATLAB, etc. Here, prescriptive languages, for example, C++, these are the prescriptive languages. And the descriptive language that describes the architecture or the hardware of the algorithm, for example, VHDL, Verilog, these are the descriptive languages here. Similarly, for the purpose of the graphical representation, we have to use the different types of the representation using the block diagram representation, signal flow graph representation, data flow graph representation, and dependence graph representation. When we are interested in order to describe the architecture, block diagram is used for the analysis of the signal flow, signal flow graph representation, and in difference equation, when we are interested for the analysis of any particular iteration, analysis at the level of iteration, for that purpose we use the data flow graph. And for the complete algorithm, we use the dependence graph here. Now, after this one, the next step is the implementation here. That is, first we have to understand our problem here. Then that, according to that problem, we will design the algorithm, and that will be converted into the implementable form of the algorithm. And then that algorithm will be converted into the form of the efficient algorithm, that is using the here the pipelining, parallel processing, folding, unfolding, timing, retiming. There are so many algorithms which we used to use in order to introduce the efficiency or in order to enhance the performance of our design algorithm. And if we got here the satisfactory result, then naturally we move towards the implementation, either using the hardware or the software. For example, in the digital signal processing, which we used to use in the BTEC year or in the fourth year, sometimes in our projects also, we use here the ID, that is the Core Composer Studio, that is utilized in order to download our algorithm to a given target. And Core Composer Studio has the different sections, that is the compiler, assembler, linker, loader, and with the help of these sections, we download our concepts on a given target. And then what happens? Here the resources of that target are here the reconfigured as per our algorithm. And then we here apply the signal and we test the performance of our designed and downloaded algorithm on a given target. So this is the approach that we used to use during the time of the design and implementation. So this is a case study through which we have gone through during our the BTEC or the graduation of courses here. And now we have to see what is the purpose, why we are trying to cover this advanced semiconductor devices and how we can utilize this one. Again, see here, what we are doing here for any particular system, whatever that may be the DSP system or that may be system or the algorithm for any other field here. First, we have to develop the theoretical concepts, and after that, for the purpose of the functional description, we have to develop here the mathematical model. And for the purpose of the architecture design, we can utilize here the different types of the languages like the prescriptive language, descriptive languages, applicative languages, or the any type of the graphical representation, that is the block diagram, signal flow graph, or the data flow graph representation here. And now after this one, we have to decide what type of the architecture has to be used for the same algorithm. There are so many types of the architecture that are possible here. In the coming PPTs and the we will discuss is that for a given here algorithm, we can utilize use here the so many architectures, so many structure here the of the algorithm. So we have to decide on a realization architecture or the structure, and then we have to decide how the coefficients of that particular algorithm will be quantized. And after the quantization of the algorithm, we have to quantize here the we have to compute the coefficient, and then we have to quantize each and everything related to our algorithm, like the input samples, output samples, and the results of the multipliers, results of the additions. These have to be also here the quantized here, and we have to take decision which type of the quantization will take place. For example, the quantization, when we say quantization, means input has to be quantized, coefficients have to be quantized, output will be also quantized here, multiplicand, product, and sum, all these will be quantized. And now when we say quantization, so in order to decide the quantization, we have to decide what will be the mode of the quantization, what will be the round mode, what will be the overflow mode, and what will be the data format here. So when we are interested in order to quantize this information, the first we will decide what is the mode. And under this category, we have to decide what is the fixed mode of the quantization, what is the float mode quantization, what is the single precision and the double precision. Here, see, as we use the number system of the two types, one is the fixed point number system and second one is the floating point number system. And in the fixed point number system, we use the format. For example, we use the qm.n format. M number of the bits are used for the integer portion and n number of the bits are used for the representation of the fractional portion, and hence the total word length becomes the m plus n plus 1, because the MSB most significant bit is utilized for the purpose of the sign here. So if we are interested for the fixed number representation, definitely we have to use the fixed mode. And in the floating mode, there are the two categories. One is the user defined, whether we have to use the user defined, then for that purpose we have to use the float mode. And if we have to use the standard, like the IEEE 7.4 standard having the 32 bit representation or the single port and the 64 representation, that are also known as the single precision and the double precision respectively. And if we are interested for the standard representation, then that is named as the single precision and the double precision, and for that purpose we will use here the mode of the single and the double. Similarly, if round mode has to be used, which round mode will be utilized, and overflow mode and the data format. So here we have to use these four aspects during the time of the quantization. And when we are interested in order to decide the round mode, then we have to select whether we are interested for the seal round mode, convergent, fixed, floor, or the round. Now see here what we are doing. We have just developed the algorithm, and whatever is the algorithm, that has to be implemented either in the hardware form or in the software form. But during the time of the implementation, we have to decide which type of the number system will be utilized in order to represent the coefficients, input, and other informations. And for that purpose, there is a need of the quantization. And for the quantization, we have to select the mode, round mode, overflow mode, and the data format mode here. And now suppose we have decided this one, that is which type of the quantization will take place. Then after this, we will write the code to realize the system here. And for example, if we again recall our BTEC classes here, then we will find that after the realization, there is a need of the testing of the design system. We give some input signal or we give some input information in order to test our design system. And for the purpose of the designing, we use to generally we use the MATLAB or any other type of the platform for the purpose of the designing, and for the purpose of the interfacing, we use the core Composer Studio as we have discussed in the previous slide. Now again, if we see, then we will find here, as we have discussed, the fixed point number system and the floating point number system. Then which one is better, fixed point or the floating point? Generally we used to say, and we used in order to design the system as a floating point. Why? We are just going to discuss this one here. That is, fixed point number system has the qm.n format. For example, if we write int 7, it means the 7 bits will be utilized in order to represent the system, and the MSB will be utilized in order to represent the sign of the coefficient or the value of the signal here. For example, if we are interested in order to represent here the 33 using the 8-bit representation, then the 33 will be represented by this one here. Similarly, 9 will be represented here. The 0 is the MSB, that is the plus sign here. Now, the floating point, here the floating point have the two type of the representation. One is the single precision and the second one is the double precision. When this is single precision, 32-bit representation, and the double precision, it has the 64-bit representation. And after representing the values in floating point mode, how we will decide the value of the that represented value or that represented number, that can be decided on the basis of that this one, that is the -1 to the power s, multiplied by 1 plus m multiplied by 2 to the power e minus bias. Here, s is the sign bit and m is the mantissa, e is the exponent value here. And now we are coming to the point why it matters, why it is better, floating point is better. Now see here the representation. We are interested in order to represent the floating point 32-bit representation, then there will be a range of the this value here from this one, that is 10 to the power minus 38 to the 10 to the power 38. And what is the accuracy? Accuracy is very, very high here. And similarly, if we represent any type of the floating point here, then we will get here the better and better accuracy. But it is not true in the case of the integer. So when we are interested in order to represent any number system, or when we are interested in order to quantize this any algorithm, then two parameters matter here. One is the dynamic range, and the second one is the precision or the resolution. Dynamic range is the here the we can say it is the ratio. When we are interested in order to represent it in the dB, then it becomes a ratio, logarithmic value of the ratio from maximum value to the minimum value. And precision and resolution, it also depends upon the here the number of the bits that we are using in order to represent this one here. And now after this one, we have, as we have discussed, there are the different types of the here the round mode for purpose of the this is the seal. And when we say seal, it rounds the object to the nearest integer value in the direction of the positive infinity, that is the towards the higher value here. And when we say floor, and floor here the rounds the value of the object to the nearest integer in the direction of the negative infinity. And when we say convergent, convergent rounds the value of the object to the here the nearest integer. And now these are the different types of the rounding approaches that are used in the time during the time of the quantization, are the rounding up, rounding round down, or round half up, round half to even, round half to odd. And they have the their specific meaning. When we say round down, round towards the negative infinity, round up, round towards the positive infinity, round halfway, round to the nearest integer with the when with tie rounding towards the positive infinity, and right it half down it will round to the nearest integer with the rounding towards the negative infinity, round half to even, and similarly round half to odd are also used for the rounding towards the nearest even number and nearest odd number respectively here. Now if we again come to the here the our here the that is, if the requirement is given or the requirements are given, then first of all we have to develop the algorithm, and after the description of the algorithm, we have to decide when it is more important to specify the functionality. When functionality is required, for that purpose we have to develop the mathematical model. And for the architectural design, we have to utilize any one approach or both approaches may be utilized here. One is the behavioral description and language, and the second one is the graphical representation. In behavioral description languages, we use the applicative languages that present a set of equations that are satisfied by the variable in the algorithm rather than a sequence of actions. For example, the Silas language used in the ethereal synthesis, or we can also use here the MATLAB for the purpose of the applicative languages here. Descriptive languages, it describes the structure of the here the system or the algorithm, for example, VHDL or the Verilog. And the prescriptive languages, it explicitly specify the order of the assignment statements. Examples are the here the programming in C. And for the graphical representation, there are the different categories. One is the block diagram representation, signal flow graph representation, and the data flow graph representation, and the dependence graph representation. As we have discussed, block diagram represents the here the hardware description, hardware architecture description here of the algorithm, and the signal flow graph gives the information about the flow of the information. Data flow one here the iteration of the algorithm, and dependence graph describes the total algorithm of about describes about the total algorithm here. Now, as we are interested in order to design any algorithm in order to process a signal digitally, then what we have to think that we have to utilize a digital signal processor, and then there is a need of the analog to digital conversion. And as we know, if there is a need of the analog to digital conversion, sampling takes place, and in order to avoid the aliasing effect, anti-aliasing, that is the low pass filter, is used before the A to D converter. Similarly, after the processing, whatever is the information that has to be converted into the analog form, and then for getting the better response, there must be the reconstruction filter here. Now, if we see any DSP processor, for example, if we consider the example of the TNS320C6713 that we also use in the DTEC level, then there is a communication with the digital signal processor, either in the analog mode, that is the analog input and the analog output, or that we can interact with the system using the digital input and the digital output, that is the LED and the DIP switches here, or here the data and ports will be utilized for the purpose of the interaction with the interface with the real world here. So there are the three modes of the interface, and if we see, then we'll find this is the processor here, and the processor is along with the other peripherals here, so that we can interact with the real world. For example, if we are interested in order to interact with the real world by the audio signal, then AIC23 codec is required here. Then multiplexing and a particular special type of the multiplexing takes place, that is known as the multiple channel buffered serial code here the in the case of this one. And the another channel is here with received with the help of the peripheral extension. Similarly, we use the JTAG, that is the joint technician group. Then there are the two types of the JTAG code. One is the here the embedded JTAG, and the second one is the external JTAG. Embedded JTAG has the USB port, and this is the external JTAG here. And for the purpose of the power supply, the power port is there, and then voltage regulation takes place. And here, as we know, here the external memory interface buses is required in order to interface the CPLD flash, SDRAM, and other here the expanded memory here. And FPI is used for the host port interface. So this is the processor along with the peripherals that is used in order to interact with the real world. And as we know, this is the physical here the layout of the that board here. What is happening in this one? What we do? We just design the algorithm as per our requirement. That is the conceptual planning takes place, then coding, building takes place, and then debugging and analyzing. And if there is any need, then modification takes place. And using the here the CCS, we download our algorithm to the given processor here with the help of the peripherals. So this is the case study which we have gone through, and this has also been described in the very first PPT. That is, first of all, we have to describe the definition here of the system. Then we have to here that define the we have to determine the parameters, and then we have to decide the which type of the system is required, analog or digital. Then derivation is required, and after the derivation, we have to follow here a design method, and after designing the method approximation or the design criteria has to be selected, and then after the any type of the criteria, there is need of the analysis. Means what is the performance of the system? When we say performance of the system, depends upon the here the four values. For any type of the system, the here what is the speed, or what is the delay related to that algorithm or the system? And the second one is that what is the area on the silicon wafer, or what is the memory space is required in order to execute or in order to implement that algorithm or the system? And the third one is that what is the power consumption or the energy required in order to implement that system? And when we are particularly interested in digital signal processing here, then the fourth parameter is also required, that is known as the here the finite word length effect. These four parameters may be considered as the four property of a diamond. That is, the value of a diamond depends upon the four property like the cut, color, clarity, and the carat. Similarly, if we are interested in order to design any system, then these four parameters has to be taken during the time of the designing and the implementation of the system here. That is the area, power consumption, and speed are the delay and the finite word length effect here. And we have also described that after for the purpose of the structural representation or the analysis, we have to use the any one type of the representation, either the graphical representation, or we have to utilize here the any type of the languages, and then we implement it using the interface. Yeah. Now we are just coming to the our point that we have gone through the different types of the semiconductor devices here. Now see, whatever is the algorithm we developed here. See, the example of one algorithm, mathematical representation is this one. Which type of the operations are required? If we see this algorithm, then we'll find the in order to implement this algorithm, or in order to analyze this type of the algorithm, the basic operations that are required are addition, multiplication, multiply, add, division that is also related to the multiplication, and then evaluation of the functions and the multivariate, etc. Here. Now, if we consider the very first one, that is the addition, because this is the base of each and every type of the operations here. Then, for the again, we go to the previous here the our previous classes. That is the what were the here the fundamental concept of the systems that were used in order to get the operation of the addition. For that one, we use here the inputs, and accordingly we decide what is the output. When we see, then we find that this is a here the propagation of the error, a propagation of the carry. That is, if the carry input is zero, here the same is propagated here. Similarly, if we see here in this one second step, so whatever is the carry, 1-1, and same has been propagated here. Now, if we see these two blocks which are shown here in the blue in color, then we find that these are the here the which type of the criteria is followed here? XR criteria is followed here. So carry propagation takes place due to the ORing XORing concepts here, and accordingly we decide that what will be the here the carry generate, and carry generate takes place due to the ANDing. And we also develop a function depending upon the K-map and other approaches. What will be the sum of the this table? What will be the carry output of this table? Then we find that sum will be represented by this one, carry will be represented by this equation here, and the carry propagate will be represented by the XORing, carry generate will be represented by the ANDing gate, ANDing operation of the in AIs and the BIs. Now see here, this is the basic adder or the basic addition circuit that will be utilized here with the help of the gates, and gates will be designed with the help of the transistor. So the naturally, whatever is the performance of the transistor, that will matter. That is the base of each and every operation in every operation of our algorithm here. So here the whatever we have covered during the in the previous classes, that has to be utilized during the time of the implementation of our algorithm at the here the device level or at the transistor level here. Now, if we see how the addition process can be enhanced, again we move towards the here the history of the this one, that is how the different types of the addition process taken place in order to enhance the performance of the addition here. Now see, this is the here the mathematical representation, and in this one again we are using the same addition, multiplication, etc. here. And in order to enhance the performance of this adder, the next step is to this can be enhanced by using a multiplexer here. You see, this is the first adder, and the second one is this can be enhanced by using a multiplexer here, and the performance of this one will be enhanced. And now if we utilize this type of the full adder for the purpose of the larger word length, then there is a addition process that will be named, and the adder will be named as the repeal carry adder. That is, whatever is the carry, carry that will propagate to the next full adder, and so on. So this type of the full adder and addition process is known as the repeal carry addition process. And that here the delay, that is the first aspect or the first parameter of our performance is the depends upon the time delay or the execution time that is required is the TD, and it is linear function of the n, that is the number of the bits which have to be added here. Now for this one, the total here the T, that is the execution time of the adder, will be equal to the n minus 1 times whatever is that execution time of required for the carry, plus the total of the time that is required for the summing the values of the two bits here. Now in order to enhance this one, the another property that that was used is the inversion property. If we use the inversion property, then the performance of this one can be enhanced a little bit here. And the next one is here, the we can use the here the carry chain of an ripple carry adder implemented using the multiplexer from the standard cell. Again, the performance will be increased in this one, and this is here we can decide what will be the critical path. What is the critical path? Critical path is the longest path between the input and out, having no delay or no energy storing element, or it is a path, but the longest path between the input and the first energy storing devices, or the longest path between the first one energy storing devices to another energy storing devices, or it is the longest path from the energy one energy devices to the output. So whatever is the critical path, whatever is the critical path, the clock cycle must be larger or equal to that of the critical path. So we have to decide the critical path, and accordingly we can compare the performances of the different types of the addition process on the basis of the critical path here. Now we are just coming to the another approaches here. For example, the simple and very popular scheme for implementation of the carry signal path using the pass transistor that were used during the time of the LSI NMOS technology, and that is known as the Manchester carry chain. And this Manchester carry chain used the pass transistor, and the use Manchester carry chain using the CMOS was the next advancement. And then there was a concept of the carry skip adder. In this one, what happens, whatever is the carry chain length, that will be reduced in this one because there is a provision of the bypass, and the ending process takes place only if there is if the ending operations output is 1, at that time the bypass will take place here. So here the performance of these addition type of the algorithm are better and better in these successive algorithms here. And now the next one was the carry skip adder or the carry save adder, and here if we compare the performance of this one, then we will see, and the carry look ahead adders also here, then we will find that the performance of the one adder is better than the previous addition method here. But what is the limitation? Whatever is the method, whether we are using the here the carry look ahead adder, carry completion adder, carry save adder, carry skip adder, whatever is the advanced process for the purpose of the addition, in these all procedures there is a carry generates and propagates. It is the delay time is smaller and smaller in successive method, but it exists in each and every case. Now the next approach, hypothetically, in this one what happens, hypothetically it was assumed that the carry generation will be eliminated. If there is no carry generation, then there no question of the carry propagation. And how this can be done? For that one, a hypothetical approach was adopted, that in previous methods we are using only the traditional number system, that is the 0 and 1 binary number system, that is known as the BID, binary digit. And what is the nature of these bits 0 and 1? They have the additive nature because both are positive, 0 and 1 both are positive. So if we anyhow introduce any one digit that is negative, for example, now we introduce here the minus 1, 0 and 1, then what will happen? When the carry is generated, then and if we using the minus 1, 0 and 1 as a bit, then for example, if we are interested in order to represent the 7, then how the 7 can be represented? 7 can be represented by the traditional method, that is the 1, 1, 1, or it can be also represented as the 8 minus 1, 9 minus 2, 10 minus 3, 11 minus 4, and so on. So there are so many methods. So what is happening here? We are using the binary signed digit number and redundancy is taking place. So it is named as the redundant binary signed digit representation. I'm repeating it. Redundant binary signed digit representation, RBSD. So if we assume this type of the operation, that is the redundant binary signed digit representation exists, or it is generated, or it is utilized, then what will happen? When the carry will be generated, that will be suppressed due to the negative nature of the minus one, and if and the totally carry generation will be eliminated, and if there is no carry generation, no question of the propagation, and hence the speed and performance of the algorithm of the addition will be very, very high or the excellent. So for the purpose of the generation of these three bits, that is the minus 1, 0 and 1, the existing bits, that is the binary digit 0 and 1, were used, and the code was generated having their combination, that is the 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Now the any one of the approach, like the MSB minus LSB or the LSB minus MSB approach, may be utilized here. So if we use this type of the approach, suppose we use the MSB minus LSB, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Then what will happen? 0 minus 0, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0. So when we utilize this type of the code, then we will get the three output. That is the minus 1, 0, and 1. Similarly, LSB minus MSB, again, we will get the three types of the three output, that is the minus 1, 0, and 1. So if we use this algorithm and say radix is in place of the 2. Now suppose this is represented as a general radix R. So the number, the range becomes from minus L to the plus L. The L range of the L is from R minus 1 by 2 to the R minus 1. R is the radix here. And here the redundancy of the number system row will be defined as the L upon R minus 1 here. So depending upon these parameters, that is the radix R and the redundancy row, means when the row is 0, that is a non-redundant number system, a traditional number system are used, they are categorized in the different type of the number system here. But when we use row is greater than 1, then this can be named as the GSD, generalized signed digit number system, and when row is equal to 1, it has the minimal GSD number system, minimal redundancy, and row is greater than 2, non-minimal GSD number system, and the minimal redundancy, again, it is categorized as alpha and beta, that is, range is from minus L to L, that is, the one is the alpha and the second one is the beta. If the alpha and beta both are same, then this will be the symmetric minimal GSD, otherwise asymmetric. And if the R is equal to 2, the radix will become the 2 redundant binary signed digit, or the redundant RBSD number system. And similarly, we can categorize other category, or we can utilize other number system. There are so many methods, so many number systems are existing on this the concept. And we can utilize the any number system in order to design here our addition, adder, and then multiplier, and hence the algorithm. And now we can compare the performance of the this algorithm to the existing or previously existing algorithms here. Now, on this basis, we are just coming to this one. When we compare the performance, if we consider the RBSD number system, and if we only consider the number of gates, or logic gates, or the transistors that are used in order to implement the addition process, using the four approaches here, the carry save adder, carry completion adder, repeal carry adder, and the RBSD number system. Then we will see here, the RBSD number system has the highest efficiency. because there is no delay here, but there is one drawback. And what is that drawback? The drawback is this one, that for the representation of any one bit, minus one, zero, or the one, we are using here the two bits. That is a combination of the two bits, that is the 00, 01, 10. So, as and we have discussed in the very beginning of our discussion in the lecture, that during the time of the performance analysis of any system, we have to consider the three parameters, at least three parameters. The first one is the speed or the delay, the second one is the area, and the third one is the power consumption. As we are using more number of the bits, so during the time of the hardware implementation or the software implementation, the area on the silicon wafer or the memory space will required memory space will be larger in this case. So we are getting here the higher speed, that is the lowest here the propagation delay, but at the case of the area here. So we can also introduce the new concept here, and the new concept will be based on a hybridization of the two methods, that is the traditional method binary number system, which has the advantage of the lower area, and this method RBSD, which has the faster algorithm. So we can hybridize these two, and the during the time of the hybridization, we have to decide the optimum hybridization, means how the these signed and unsigned numbers will be selected, and that will be known as the hybrid signed digit number system. There are so many papers available, and so research so many researches have been gone on the basis of the hybrid number system and the RBSD number system. And the optimum solution is the alternate method, that is the traditional then signed, traditional then signed, like that. And on the basis of that one, we can decide here the optimization, and then we can design our addition method. And again, after designing and deciding the design of addition multiplication, we can develop our the algorithm for the purpose of the requirement, and then we can compare the performance of this algorithm to the previous existing algorithm. I think there is a need of so again, after this one, here we are coming to the point how the conversion of the binary to the RBSD number system, because we use the binary number system. So first need is conversion of binary to RBSD number system. For example, say if we are interested in order to convert the binary number system to the RBSD, then first digit, namely X, can be written in the digit position. Whatever is the digit position, the binary number X will be written accordingly here. Then generated borrow digit VI, which is left shifted, and then generate a DI, that is done just the changing the ones into the minus one. Here the if we write here the one and at here the one bar, that is the minus one here. So here if the example we have taken the 12 is written as the 1100, and the position is written in the same similar manner as we have described in the first step. The 12 is written, then here the in order to generate the borrow digit, shifted towards the left side, and then generate the DI by changing the 1 into minus 1, and now add them in order to generate the RBSD number system. When we add them, that is here that we see these two 0 and no digit is there, so the 0 0 0 0, minus 1 0, minus 1, minus 1 1 0, and this will become 1. So this is the RBSD number system that has been generated equivalent to the binary number system here. Now see, if we are interested in order to convert the RBSD number system to the binary, then how this will be converted? We have to separate the positive and negative bit position, bit numbers, and along with their positions. So here if you see, then this is equal to how much? This is the 1, then all will become here the 00, that is the 16, and this is the 1, then 00, that is the 4. 16 minus 4, that will become the 2 here. Or we can see another, the same here we have described that from the table, the what is the binary number system, that is the here consider the ZI plus, that is when only positive ones are replaced by the plus one, and minus ZI minus when the only negative one are replaced by the minus one here. And then we will consider this one and represent this one. For example, if we consider the 1, 4, 3, then 1, 4, 3 in the RBSD number system is represented by this one, and the positive numbers are represented by the ZI plus, negative number ZI minus, and when we subtract the ZI minus from the ZI plus, then we will get this number system, that is the 1, 4, 3, that is in binary number system. So what we have to do, the first is the conversion of binary to RBSD, then addition process, and after the addition, again the conversion of RBSD to binary here. So the three steps are required in order to design the addition method using the RBSD number system. And here we have compared the performances of the some adders. For example, using the signed digit RBSD ripple carry adder, Pog Stone Coomb adder, and this is the CSA carry save adder, hybrid signed digit adder. And in this one, we will find that the fastest speed is in the case of the RBSD, but the HSD is the optimum solution for the purpose of the implementation. Now, again, we are coming to the same point, that is, in order to design the system, first the requirements are required, whatever are the requirements, those will be converted in the form of the algorithm. Then description of the algorithm will take place, and if we are interested for the functional level designing, then that will be represented by the mathematical equation. For the architectural designing, any one of the approach or both approaches may be utilized, that is the behavioral description languages, graphical representation. And in behavioral description languages, we have to use the applicative language, prescriptive language, and the descriptive languages here. And for the graphical representation, we can use here the block diagram representation, signal flow graph representation, data flow graph representation, and the dependence graph representation. As we have described, that the block diagram is related to the architecture. Signal flow gives the information about the signal flow, and the graph here, the data flow is related to the one iteration of the algorithm. For the complete algorithm, we will use the dependence graph here. These are the four types of the graphical representation. Now see, the same is described here, and for the signal flow graph, we use the collection of the nodes, directed edges. Nodes are the computation. If the directed edges is JK, that is the branch originating from the node J and ending at node K. Directed is linear transformation of a node output. Example is the delay and the constant multiplier, etc. And if we describe the source node, node with no input is sync node, node with no output is, and SFG, signal flow graph, is the here the closest to actual hardware implementation. We are just going to utilize some data flow graph representation in order to introduce the pipelining and the parallel processing. For that purpose, we are just giving here the a brief about the signal flow graph, data flow graph, and the dependence graph here. The data flow graph is the combination of the nodes representing tasks via the directed edges. Directed edges can have only a non-negative number of the delays. Directed edges indicate dependence relation between the node for node A and B. If the edge A directed toward bits has no delay, the BK can be computed only after computing the AK. And this type of the dependency is known as the intra-iteration dependency, if there is no delay. And if A to B has M delay, M is greater or equal to 1, then BK depends upon availability of the AK minus M information or the input. And this type of the dependency is known as the inter-iteration dependence. BFG captures the data flow between the various subtasks and computation time of each node shown in the parentheses. For example, say, if we are interested in order to design a three-tap FIR filter, that is a second-order FIR filter, then the three-tap FIR filter represented something like in this manner, that is a single flow graph of this one, is this one. Here the, and now if we are interested in order to get the transposition of this one, then the transpose structure of this one can be achieved by reversing all arrow direction, that is branching node becomes adder node and the adder node becomes the branching node, and then interchanging the input and output. If we do this one, then we will get this type of the architecture here. Now when we apply here this type of the transposition, then what will happen? Now this will be the Xn. Xn is the input. It will be available to all the branches, and this type of the architecture is known as the top first architecture. And if we see, then we will find whatever is the critical path delay in this one, that is the direct form realization, and this is the transpose realization. In the transpose realization, we will get the lower critical path length than that of the direct form realization. Here we have considered one example, that is the yn is ayn minus 1 plus xn. We just recall here the general expression which we have described in the very first PPT named as the ARMA model. It is a one special case of that ARMA model here. Yn is equal to Ayn minus 1 plus Xn. And graphically, it can be represented something like this. It will take 1 minute. And after this delay, whatever is the signal, it will be multiplied by the A. And this will be added to the Xn, and this will become the Yn. And with the help of the data flow graph, this can be represented in this manner, that is the node represents the execution of the addition and the branching in this one, and the delay is represented by this one, and execution time is represented by represented in the parenthesis here. A is the addition here, and the B is the multiplication. This is the multiplication, and this is the addition here. So the two here the tasks are defined. One is that for the addition, and the second one is for the multiplication with the help of the BFG. Now the third one is dependence graph, that is known as the DG dependence graph. It describes the complete algorithm. For example, here we have taken the example of the yn is equal to w0 xn plus w1 xn minus 1 w2 xn minus 2 and so on. We have considered here the weight w0 w1 w2, and we have multiplied this one, that is the x0, x1, x2 as per this equation, and accordingly we will get here the yn. This is the dependence graph that describes the complete algorithm. And what is the advantage of this one? That the dependence graph results in an extremely regular modular array that is useful for the VLSI architecture like the systelic array design here. Now we are moving to the concept of the pipelining and parallel processing. Suppose there is some requirements are given. From that requirement or from those requirements, we have to derive the algorithm. And then now that algorithm will be represented with the help of the DFG. And now we can introduce the concept of the pipelining and parallel processing in order to enhance the performance of the design algorithm here. Pipelining is nothing, but in this one, what we do, for example, we introduce here the number of the delays in the critical path. So what happens? The reduction in the critical path length takes place, and hence the clock rate or the clock speed is enhanced. And it reduces the power consumption if we consider the speed same. And parallel processing, that is the single input, single output system is converted into the multiple input, multiple output, that is the parallelism takes place. Increase the effective sampling speed and reduction of the power consumption. Now, if we consider a three-tap FIR filter, and it is represented as the YN, AXN plus BXN minus 1 plus CXN minus 2 here. Now see here, the what will be the critical path? This is the graphical representation. The XN is this one. YN is nothing but the AXN plus BXN minus 1, where the XN minus 1 and multiplied by the B plus CXN minus 2. This is the YN. Now we see the critical path. Critical path length, as we have defined, that it must be longest path amongst the input and output. That is, this path is a between the input and output without any delay or the energy storing device. Between the any two consecutive delays, these are the two consecutive delays, but it is not the longest path because it has no execution unit. Here there are the three computational unit. One is the multiplier, two adder here, and the delay and output, one multiplier, two adder, delay and output, one adder and the one multiplier. So there are the four paths, and these among these four paths, here we can say this one, that is the Xn to the Yn or Xn minus 1 to the Yn. I think there is a need of the deck. Am I right?
So participants, we are going to take a 5 minute short break. We will meet after 5 minutes. Please sit here. Thank you.
Participants, we are taking 5 minutes breaks. In the meantime, if you have any query regarding this, you can place your question in chat box. So we'll have 5 minutes of break, then we'll resume the session.
So we are back to resume the session, and I request respected speaker to start the session. To resume the session, please.
Madam,
yes sir, you are audible, sir.
Thank you.
Yes sir, you are audible.
Okay, thank you madam. So once again I welcome you all in this session, and as we are discussing about the pipelining and parallel processing concept that will be involved in order to enhance the performance of our designed algorithm. And we have discussed that the pipelining, when we use the pipelining, then it reduces the critical path length and hence increases the clock speed. And if we are interested in order to maintain the same speed, then it reduces the power consumption. And parallel processing, it converts the single input into the single input, single output system into the multiple input, multiple output system, utilizing the parallel input concept. And the it increases the effective sampling speed, and reduction of the power consumption takes place due to the parallel processing here. And in order to describe the pipelining, first of all, we are taking the example of the three-type FIR filter. Suppose we have utilized a three-type FIR filter, that is a second order FIR filter. Then this is the YN A XN plus B XN minus 1 plus C X N minus 2. So the critical path will be here, the as we have described that the critical path will be this one, the longest path between the X N and Y N, or between the this one, that is the input of the, at the X N minus 1 to the Y N. Because the other paths have the lower number of the execution time than that of these two paths have the same length, a critical length. So this any one of them may be considered as a critical path length. So for the purpose of the processing, or for the purpose of the execution of any iteration, the clock pulse must be greater or equal to this critical path length. And what is the critical path length? If we assume that the time required to execute one multiplication operation is the TM, and the time of the execution that is required for the one addition is TA, then the sampling time period T sample must be greater or equal to the TM plus twice of the TA. And similarly, we can define what must be the sampling frequency here for this one. It must be less or equal to the 1 upon TM plus twice of the TA here. Now, pipelining or the parallel processing will be introduced in this one. And for this purpose, say if we have this, for example, if we consider any other algorithm that is represented with the help of the signal flow graph here. And now if we see the Xn is the input, and it is multiplied by the An, and then it is multiplied by the Bn, and then we are getting here the output. Means here the, oh sorry, An is added to the Xn, and then Bn is added to the Xn plus An, and hence we are getting here the output Yn. So in this one, we are getting here the output after the two addition. So what will be the critical path? The two addition time that is required for this one is the critical path. Now we introduce here the any one delay between the two adders here. Then this introduction of the delay reduces the critical path length, and the introduction of the energy storing devices in the critical path is named as the pipelining. So the question is how the pipelining will take place, and how the these energy storing devices or the delays will be introduced, and what will be the location and position where they will be introduced, or where they will be located here. Now the first one is this, that this is the pipelining, and if we duplicate the same one in order to process the two samples at the same time, then this is the parallel processing here. Now again we are coming to the this one here, that is the three tap FIR filter, and in order to introduce the pipelining concept, there is a need to introduce the energy storing devices or the device in the critical path. And in order to decide the location and position where the critical, where the delay or the energy storing devices will be placed, is decided on the basis of the cut set algorithm. And in this one, if we we use the feed forward cut set algorithm. See here, the two iterations are computed concurrently in this one after the introduction of this one. Before the introduction of the delay devices, that is before the pipelining or before the applying the cut set algorithm, this is the three tap FIR filter. And here we will decide the position and the location of the cut set algorithm. And the, according to this algorithm, we have to select those branches or the edges which are sufficient in order to separate the total network into the two sections. Because if we eliminate these two branches, that is this one and this one, then this will be broken into the two sections here. So here we have selected this one, and at the point of the cut, we will introduce the delay or the energy storing devices here. And accordingly, what is happening, the previously the critical path length was the PM, that is the execution time required for one multiplier, and say this is near about the 10 nanosecond, and for the adder say it is the 2 nanosecond. Then here this will become the 10 plus 2 plus 2 before the pipelining, that is the 14 nanosecond. But after the pipelining, what will be the critical path length? Now there are the three branches that may be considered critical path length, because all these three branches have the same complexity, that is the same number of the adder and the multiplier. For example, if we see this one, multiplier, one multiplier, one adder, one multiplier and one adder, and this one is one multiplier and the one adder. That is the delay devices to output. Here the input to the first delay devices to the delay devices. So here the critical path length has been reduced from 14 nanosecond to 10 plus 2, that is the 12 nanosecond. Or in general, we can say previously it was the TM plus 2A, and now it is the TM plus TA. But what is the drawback here? The latency increases here. Latency is increasing. Why the latency is increasing? Because of the introduction of the delay devices or the energy storing devices here. So if we are introducing here the M level of the pipelining, then M level pipeline system, the number of the delay elements in any part from input to output is the M minus 1, greater than that in the same part in the original sequential circuit. Pipelining reduces the critical path but leads to penalty in terms of an increased latency. And what is the latency? That is the difference in the availability of the first output data in the pipeline system and the sequential system, that is without pipeline here. So two main drawbacks are the increase in number of the latches in the system, and latency of the system is also increased here. The speed of the DSP architecture or the clock period or the clock rate is limited by the longest path between any two latches, which we have just described during the time of the description of the critical path length. That is, between any two latches, are between an input and a latch, are between a latch and and output or between the input and the output here. Now, the longest path or the critical path can be reduced by placing the pipelining latches at the suitable places here. And pipelining latches can only be placed across the feed forward cut set of the graph here. This is important that during the time of the replacing the placing the here the latches, we have to select only the feed forward cut set. The cut set is a set of the edges of a graph such that if these edges are removed from the graph, then the graph becomes disjoint. And feed forward cut set is a cut set is allowed a feed forward cut set if the data move in the forward direction on all the edges of the cut set. And if there is any edge that has a backward direction, the flow of the information, then that will not be considered in the feed forward cut set. Now, if we consider here the example, say this is the graphical representation or the data flow graph, signal flow graph representation of any algorithm here, then the critical path is from A3 to A5, A4, and A6. And this will be come to the 4-unit time here. And if we consider the figure B, then in figure B, it is not a valid pipelining because it has not all feed forward cut set. And this one is the valid cut set. So we will apply here the D analysis on this location and positions in order to get the pipeline architecture here. Suppose there, if we introduce here the pipelining and parallel processing both, and if the L level of the pipelining takes place at the same time M level of the parallel processing also takes place, then the clock T clock will be reduced by the T clock by L multiplied by the M. That is, it will be reduced L times due to the pipelining and M time. L time due to the process parallel processing and M time due to the pipelining stages here. Now suppose we are interested in order to calculate the power consumption, what will be the enhancement in power consumption due to the pipelining or the parallel processing. So first of all, we have to calculate what is the propagation delay. This propagation delay will depend upon these values, that is the C charge. C charge is the total charge of the transistor or the CMOS transistor. VO is the supply voltage to the transistor. VT is the threshold voltage. K is constant here. Then the power propagation delay will be calculated by this one, that is the C charge multiplied by V0 divided by K times V0 minus VT its whole square. And power consumption will become the whatever is the C total of that circuit and V naught square multiplied by F here. And when we apply here the pipelining, then what will be the power consumption? And before pipelining, that is the when the circuit is sequential, then the here the power consumption will be the C total V naught square multiplied by F. F is 1 upon T sequential. That is the time required for the execution in the sequential circuit here. Now suppose we introduce here the M label of the pipelining. Then what will happen to the frequency? The working at the, if the frequency is maintained same, that is the working takes place at the same frequency, and it remains unchanged, then and the C total is the total capacitance of the CMOS circuit, then if we calculate this one for the sequential circuit and after the pipelining here, then for the T sequential, as we have described in the previous formula, this will be this one. And for the pipelining, this will become here the k by n times here, and say the beta times the power, here the voltage supply is required in the pipeline architecture. Then here the VO will be replaced by the beta naught VO. But both have the same frequencies. So here that T sequential and the T pipeline, both must be same here. So this is the relation, and we get here the quadratic equation in terms of the beta. Hence beta will have the two values. For example, if we consider here the three type FIR filter, and TM is 10 unit time, TA is 2 unit time, CM is the 5 times of the CA, that is the charge capacitance of the, this is the capacitance of the multiplier, and CA is the capacitance of the adder here. Pipeline multiplier is the TM1. See, in the multiplier, when we see the multiplier is a combination of the gates and the transistor. So even in the multiplier, we can apply here the pipeline. So when the multiplier itself is pipeline, it is named as the fine grain pipelining. So if we consider here the fine grain pipelining, and say the first section has the 6 unit time, and the second section has the 4 unit time, and the capacitance of the first section is the 3 times of the capacitance of the adder, and the second one is the 2 times of the capacitance of the addition or the adder here. That is the 5A has been divided into the 3CA and the 2CA. And VO is, that is supply voltage is 5 volt, and VT threshold voltage is the 0.5 volt. And now if we solve this equation according to this quadratic equation, then we will find that beta has the two values. One is the 0.6033, and the second one is the beta is 0.00239. But this value will not be considered here, because if we consider this value of the beta, then beta VO will become here the 0.1195, that is less than the threshold voltage. So we will go for this one, that is the beta is 0.6099. So the voltage, that is the supply that is required for the pipeline architecture, is beta times VO, that is the 3.0165 volt, and the power consumption ratio beta square will become the 36.4%. So here the improvement in power saving is near about the 36.4% due to the pipelining. Now, as we have discussed in the previous slide, that our objective is to develop the algorithm, and hence we are interested to develop the efficient algorithm for the purpose of the designing and the implementation. And before the enhancement of the algorithm, if we consider here the three type, we have considered here the three type FIR filter, and we have also discussed how the critical path length of this FIR filter has been reduced due to the pipelining. And for example, here we have considered that the execution time of the one multiplier is the 10 nanosecond and one adder is the 4 nanosecond. Then how the critical path length will be reduced by using here the pipelining concept. The second concept, that is the fine grain pipelining. Say this is the multiplier here, this is the pipeline architecture, and this architecture may be also converted into the transposed architecture, that is named as the broadcast, and this will become here broadcast structure. That is the, this is the total adder here, and this is the adder, and this is the adder here. And now in that this is a delay, and then addition, delay and addition here. And if n is input, that is the input is available to all the branches, and this is named as the broadcast architecture. Now, if we are interested in order to apply here the pipelining in this multiplier, having the 10 unit execution time, and say we have utilized here the cut set algorithm, and that this is replaced in such a manner that first section has the 6 unit time, and the second section has the 4 unit time, then this type of the pipelining is named as the fine grain pipelining. (Clears throat) Now, in parallel processing, what happens is that whatever is the input, that will be duplicated. Suppose we consider here the, again, three-type FIR filter, that is YN is equal to AXN plus BXN minus 1 plus CXN minus 2 here. And that data broadcast structure of this one, that is by changing the XN, position of the XN and YN, and by changing the location and position of the here the branching and the adding branches, branching and the adding nodes here, then we will get here the data broadcast structure here. In this one, the critical path length is the PM plus twice PA, but in this case, we will get here the critical path length is the PM plus PA. So without any extra effort, when we only change the architecture, as we have discussed in the very beginning, that for the same algorithm, we can get the different architecture of the algorithm here. And if we are in position to convert this one into the data broadcast structure, then we are getting here the better performance in terms of the critical path, because the critical path length is reduced, and we can say the speed is enhanced in this case here. Now suppose we are interested in order to introduce the three-level parallel processing, then yn, that is n will be replaced by the k, and we will write here the equation for the y3k, y3k plus 1, y3k plus 2 in terms of the yn here. And we will get these equations here. And now the sampling time period will be reduced by the whatever is the critical path divided by the L, and here the L is 3, so this will be divided by the 3 here. And what is the time of the critical path? That is the TM plus TA, if we use the data broadcast. And after parallel processing, whatever is the critical path, that will be also reduced by the value of the L. That is the L, the level of the parallel processing here. For this equation, we can get here the this architecture. That is the, now in place of processing only one sequence, the three sequences will be processed at the same time. There is one more concept that is used for the enhancement of the performance of any algorithm, that is the unfolding. Unfolding is a transformation technique to create a new program describing more than one iteration of the original program. And now say this is the one input, one output, and here it has been converted into the two parallel processing. That is the, now this will be the two sequences will be processed in place of the one sequence here. For example, if we consider the yn is equal to a yn minus 9 plus xn, and we are interested in order to apply here the unfolding, then we can get this type of the architecture. Now we are describing how we will get this type of the architecture. In order to get the unfolding architecture, the graph based technique is used, in which we will use that this one is the open domain. X is defined as the in such a manner that if we divide the 11 by 4 and its value is approximated, then this will be the integer value, that is the 2 here. Similarly, if the a percentage b will be defined in such a manner, that is the 11 is the 11 percentage by 4 will be 3, that is an integer value towards the next higher integer here. Similarly, this will be the 20 remainder will be represented in this one. That is the 4, 2 is 8, or 3 is the remainder. 3, 7 is 21, and remainder is the 2 here. So by applying these two concepts, we are interested in order to construct a J unfolded DFT. J level of the unfolding will take place. So there will be the J nodes, starting from the U0 to UJ minus 1. For each S U to V, there will be the W delays in the original DFG, and this may be defined as the UI to VI plus W percentage with J, that is whatever is the remainder that will be defined here, with I plus J, I plus W divided by J delays for I is equal to 0 here. Now say if this is the DFG, data flow graph for any algorithm, and we are interested in order to get the unfolding algorithm, Then applying this one, we can get here the unfolded architecture. And in this one, what is happening? The number of the sequences that will be processed will be higher, and we will get the better performance. Similarly, we can get here the higher level of the unfolding following the same procedure here. So again, we are coming to the digital signal processing. In the digital signal processing, the digital filters are the main processing algorithms. For appropriate reduction in the power consumption and improvement in speed, the structures, that is the direct form, data broadcast, cascade, parallel, and transport, these type of the structures are used, and we select any particular type of the structure. Major factors for selection of the specific realizations: computational complexity, memory requirement, and finite word length effect. That is the speed, power consumption, area, as well as the finite word length effect. Due to its absolute stability and the linear phase property, FIR filters and the extensive applications in mobile communication and for channel equalization, noise filtering. And here, if we are interested in order to analyze the performance of the system, then efforts towards developing algorithms for efficient implementation of the FIR filters on ASIC and the FPGA. The different types of the algorithms can be utilized. For example, the core of the convolution of any type of the filtration, core of the algorithm is the convolution for any type of the filtering process here. So the efficient algorithm to optimize the cost of the multiplication depends upon the different types of the algorithms that will be utilized for the purpose of the multiplication. Now we are just describing here the some algorithms like the MCM, multiple constant multiplication approach. This method replaces all traditional multipliers by an MCM block following the transposed direct form structure, and the numerical transformation techniques for reducing the complexity of the computation. In these transformation rely upon sub expression elimination to develop the new structure of the for the purpose of the computation. And in the next algorithm is the CSE, that is the common sub expression elimination method. And in these algorithms, we are reducing the complexity, naturally the performance will be enhanced. For further elimination in the redundancy, modified iteration mesh that efficiently performs bitwise mesh and then uses the pattern corresponding to the best mesh here, MITM approach is used. And there is a combination of the MCM and MITM approaches. And in order to enhance the performance, the CSD, canonical signed digit representation, is used in this one. See here, we are just representing the, these are the methods that are used in this one. Here see the algorithm that is used for the MITM. It uses a modified iterative matching process that consists of the following steps. The first step is the normalize the filter coefficient and represent them in CSD form. And then find and eliminate any repetition of any constant and determine the number of the bitwise matches. Then calculate the number of non-zero bits for all pairs of the constant. Choose the best matches and select the set of bits that is based on criteria such as it's at the maximum number of bitwise matches. And in the step 6, eliminate the redundancy. And then after finding the best match, the set of coefficient is updated. Return the remainders and redundancy bits of the entire coefficient, and then repeat the steps from 2 to 8 until the iteration condition allows the algorithm to find common pattern among constant. Now if we apply this one, and we compare the performances of these algorithms in a four type FIR filter, that is having the third order filter. Yes, for a particular purpose, we have designed the filter having the particular values of the coefficients. And now if we compare the performances of the different algorithms, then we will find that without the algorithm, the, what is the total number of the error, sector, and the optimization ratio here, then we will find that MITM is better in comparison of this one. And this is the graphical representation of this one. Now, so far we have discussed how the algorithm is developed, and for the purpose of the implementation of the design algorithm, we have to use the devices, because with the help of the devices, the gates are developed, and these, with the help of these gates, we have to develop the different approaches for the purpose of the addition. Even we can use the different types of the number system, like the binary number system, RBSD, CSD, or the carry, here the CSD number system, or the HSD number system, hybridized signed digit number system. Or we can use a different pattern of addition for the purpose of the optimization of the algorithm. Now if we see, then we'll find we have to follow the three steps. First is the identification process, what is the requirement, and for which purpose we are interested to design the system, and then we have to quantify it, and the third step is the implementation here. And after following this, and naturally for each and every steps, we have to use the different types of the tools and algorithms, and we have to introduce the different computational level intelligence methods here, AI, etc. here. And now we are coming to the here our main goal, that is the goal of the teaching, learning, and the research objective here. The main goal is the behavior modification, and how this modification takes place here. See here, that for the given input or the stimulus, we perceive it. After perception, we store it and is in our brain for which purpose, so that we can reproduce it at the time of the requirement. And if it is so, then it is named as the idea. And on the basis of this idea, if we are in position to perform, then it is named as the concept. And on the basis of the concept, we perform. Yes, what is the response? What is the output? And that response or the performance is compared with our targeted goals or the desired output. If it is okay, naturally we will try to move for other goals. Otherwise, we have to reinforce it. Now, for this purpose, that is for the purpose of the perception, storing, retrieving, conceptualization, performing, the basic requirement is the attention. If we are focused towards our goal, only then we can achieve our goal by these steps here. And for the purpose of the attention, there is a need of the motivation, either the external motivation or the internal motivation here. And external motivation or the internal motivation, both depends upon the basic needs. So if the basic needs are fulfilled, then naturally we will move towards this behavior modification that is named as the learning. Why the learning? We can learn from the society so that we can enhance the performance in the society, we can pay the society through the teaching learning process, having the four steps, that is the monologue, that is named as the teaching or the demonstration, dialogue, that is the case study, tutorial, group discussion, question answers, and then actions by the project work, lab work, and then by the self study, that is the practical task. And this is named as the transfer of the knowledge, that is from the learned person to the persons who have curiosity to learn it, that is teacher centered to the student centered, and it is named as the student autonomy, so that students can teach themselves. So that what is the goal here to our teaching learning is that teachers have to teach themselves and learner has to learn. Teacher has to learn how the learners learn, and the learners have to teach themselves. And when this takes place, there are the different steps, like the lectures in which learning takes place by the 5%, reading 10%, in audiovisual 20%, demonstration 30%, group discussion, we improve our learning by the 50%, and practice by doing 75%, teaching others, we improve our learning by the 90%, and it is named as, sometimes we call it, the Tamsoma Jyotirgamaya. Now we come to the point again that we can say that teaching learning is a process in which we utilize the rules, regulations, concepts given by the mathematicians, scientists, or the senior persons from the society in order to learn ourselves and to maintain the existing system, or to enhance the existing system, or to design and implement the new system here. So after the teaching learning, next step is the research, and after the research, the invention takes place. After invention, test and application, then at risk level, we can file the patent, and on the basis of this file, we can apply for the fund, and we can assume a virtual company here, and we can submit the business plan. After getting some grant, we can again apply for the get the property rights or the license, then to the federal agencies for the research proposal, and for after getting the grant, sales and services and discovery, we can apply for the discovery grant, and naturally after getting the grants and efforts, we can develop our independent company, and we can serve ourselves, and we can serve the society. So here we have just started from the basic devices, and we try to convey our goal, what is the goal of the teaching learning. So thank you all for the patience hearing, and thanks to organizers also, and if there is any question, then please.
I thank you, respected speaker. So the session is now open for any queries if you have.
So this lecture will be also available on the YouTube, and the link will be provided to you. If you are interested, then you can go for it. I think there
we thank you to our speaker for this very informative session related to the devices. And there is an announcement that we are going to take lunch break now, so we will meet again at 2 p.m. with a very very interesting lecture that is related to the title of the lecture is Biosensors in Food Technology, and that will be delivered by Professor Parth Pratim Sahu. So we are taking a lunch break, and we'll meet at 2 p.m. shortly. Thank you all for your presence.